5. To block this call and all future calls, press 7. To reject this call, hang up now. You may begin speaking now.
Hello, welcome to Convict Inc. I'm your host, Robert Rosso. It is Thursday, November 21st. Excuse me, I just woke up from my evening nap. My late afternoon nap, I should say. It's after count time, by the way. So we get out of count at... We get off count at 5 o'clock. It's like 5:37 right now. Anyway, I mean, that's why my voice... I took a nap during those... During that time. Anyway, lots of things in the news lately with cases pertaining to the death penalty. Specifically, we had this... Or not. Or people maybe that should have been... subject to the death penalty. That's Susan Smith out of South Carolina. Then you have the guy that killed the four people who's getting ready to go on, getting ready to start his trial out of Utah, or is it Idaho, that sick fuck that killed the four college students. And then you have the Ibarra guy who just got found guilty by a judge, not a jury, out of Georgia on the Lincoln Riley case. And they decided not to charge him with the death penalty. So I'm gonna weigh in and talk a little bit about all these cases. First of all, many of you know that I was at FCI Terre Haute for, 9 years? And across the street, over at the USP, they have the new federal death row. That's where all the federal prisoners are housed over there at Terre Haute. So we used to get information about them quite a bit, meaning what's going on over there. I've done some videos about it. Who was the one that was most feared? What's their reaction when Trump won the first time and so forth? Now, I have not talked to any inmates that are in Terre Haute, that is at the FCI or at the USP as of late, nor have I talked to any correction officers. I had 3 correction officers, I think it was, at one time, coming out of Terre Haute that were sending me information about that place. But anyway, I do know this. When Trump, I will tell you this right now, the day Trump won, when they woke up and found out that Trump won, there was tears, crying, probably you can hear it over there on death row. The first time that Trump won, absolutely, there was guys that were crying in a state of shock because they know what time it is. Executed or allowed the death penalty to go forward on 13 people, I guess it was, during his last reign, and that was towards the end of his presidency. I remember that was during COVID too. I mean, I was there during all that. What a bitch that was. We were locked down constantly. I mean, just what a pain in the ass. But I will follow up and do some stories about that. I have a lot of information about what happened out of there, and some photos of guys getting wheeled. 2 guys getting wheeled for sure. 2 different ones getting wheeled to the execution chamber. I actually have those photos. Anyway, I can assure you right now, those guys are not having a good time. And I would say that it's going to happen relatively quick when they start doing this. Now, Biden has put a moratorium on the death penalty. You know, he's done that liberal bullshit where they've, like in California, where they just have all death row filled up. You know, a lot of them thought they were going to skate through it. A lot of them have been under 20 years or more. The last time he cranked up the death penalty, he started off with the guy that was a so-called white supremacist. He was really a flunky for a case that happened out of Arkansas. The family members of him actually didn't want him to die. I forgot his name. They called him Cyclops. I know that. He had one eye. But he didn't even do the killings in the case. He just didn't rat on his co-defendant. But whatever. The family members, the judge, everybody didn't want this guy to die for whatever reason. I think the Kehoe was the name of the guy who actually did it. It was a kind of some white supremacy bullshit. But anyway, now, moral of the story, just to reiterate, those guys on death row right now, not having a good time. And it's going to be something to see how many people, or if that place even gets cleared out. I don't know how many are ready, like how many do have execution dates as of right now. But it's going to be interesting to see. and I feel sorry for the guys over in Terre Haute that have to get locked down because they're all locked down when that stuff happens. On that note,
this call is from a federal prison.
Terre Haute is an old prison, and I would not be surprised if they shut it down. By the way it looks, they're going after old, dilapidated prisons that don't need to be there no more. Terre Haute FCI would be perfect to get rid of. I'm just saying. A lot of good people that work there. A lot of good COs that I like work there. Staff members that I have respect for. I'm sure they won't lose their jobs, most of them, but they can get transferred someplace else in the BOP. Hell, they're in dire need of work everywhere, so they'll be fine if they want to travel. But that prison, I look forward to go. Anyway, let's talk about these other cases in the media. First, you have, is it Jose Ibar? That's the Lincoln Riley, the guy who killed her out of Venezuela. What a tragedy this case was. So you got this guy, he's supposedly a gang member, and I say supposedly because, like with MS-13, Trump put the boogeyman jacket on MS-13 because of some of the stuff that they did. There's some MS-13 guys who are behind the door on the range on the other side of me. You wouldn't look at these guys as no boogeyman, okay? I guess you can get anybody with three or more people, put them in a little pack, and people can be vicious and dangerous. You can take three complete lames or three complete sex offenders that are just pansies that can actually do something very heinous. So I am hesitant when they talk about this new Venezuela gang. I don't know enough about it. But anyway, supposedly, and I forgot how you say the name, but anyway, he goes and he goes actually hunting for this girl. He was going to hunt to rape and then kill a girl, or maybe his intent wasn't to kill, but it was definitely to hunt to rape a girl. She's a college student. She turns around and she fights for her life. He ends up killing her. He goes, the prosecutor in this case decides not to go after the death penalty. And I don't know if you guys caught it, but the reason is because one of the reasons is because he's a legal alien. Because of the complications that came with all that. That was actually stated by the AG's office in Georgia, by the attorney general down there. Can you believe that? Because he's in the country illegal, they didn't want to pursue the death penalty. And now he has a constitutional right to medical care, by the way. Everybody think about that again. You out there, everybody who's listening to this, you do not have the constitutional right to medical care. You do not. I do. Everybody in prison does. He does. A constitutional right to medical care. That was a death penalty case all day. Okay? I got a call back. Bye. So here it is. So this will be part two. Anyway, so the other two cases is the guy out of Utah. Or is it Idaho that killed the college girls? Anyway, this is a classic example of a case that should be a death penalty case. The lawyers on this, what did they file? Like 126, 127 page brief trying to get the death penalty taken off the table. The judge came back, and rightly so, said no. You know, not only does that state have the death penalty, but the Supreme Court has ruled on it that the death penalty is constitutional. And I am actually an advocate for child rape being a death penalty offense. So anyway, that case is properly a death penalty case. And if the guy did it and he gets found guilty, I do hope that the family members are not stupid and sit there and say, well, he got a just punishment. For the rest of his life, he's going to have to sit in prison and think about it. I'm going to get to that in just a minute. First, I want to get to Susan Smith. Susan Smith, out of South Carolina. I can't believe that case has been 30 years. As a matter of fact, I'm 55. I said that would have made me 25. And I swear I could have remembered being in a certain place when I watched that case. I thought I was in California, but I did not live in California at that time. That means that I would have had to have been 25, living in Arkansas at the height of my meth use, which is a little weird, but anyway, so because I remember that case well, and I wasn't watching too much TV at that time. But Susan Smith, married, had two little boys, 14 months and 3 years old, and she went and drowned them over a guy. She was screwing around on her husband with somebody, and the guy didn't want kids, and she put them in the back of a car, strapped them in their car seat, rolled them in the lake, and drowned them. They found, when they found the bodies and they did the diving, the guy said what he remembers most is seeing one of the oldest kid's handprint on the hand pushed up against the window. I mean, just terrible, terrible case. Now, that case, I don't know if they had, for whatever reason, that was not a death penalty case. I don't know why they took it off the table, or I'm pretty sure South Carolina has a death penalty, but for whatever reason, they didn't, okay? So let's not rewind the clock. They didn't, period. They gave her life, okay? I am for a sentence like that, meaning she goes up for parole in 30 years. I do not think there should be such a penalty as life without the possibility of release. Too many things change. Way too many things happen. Prisons can run out of money. People change. Attitudes change. Society changes. Too many things can happen, okay? And I actually believe people should start going up in 20 years, not 30 years, okay? Anyway, in her case, she goes up for parole, shows some bit of remorse, if that's possible. The husband steps up, says no. He wants her in prison for the rest of her life. She goes up every year, every 2 years, and he says he's going to be there. Now, do I think she should be out of prison? Totally irrelevant. The deal is, there is the father of the two kids. He doesn't want her out. Now, I think she actually got pregnant when she was behind bars. So her institutional records, I think that needs to be looked at. I think that there's a lot of factors that come into place. Psychology reports, there can be a lot into play. And you've got to also take the weight of the father. But I do believe in that sentence. I do believe that there should be a life sentence with the possibility of parole. I'm not so sure that I believe that if she goes up every 2 years and the father says no, that they should just hang it on what the father says, though. I'm just not. I believe in that type of sentence is all I'm trying to say, okay? Meaning that somebody has the chance of parole. What else? So that the Susan Smith, let's go back to the Ibarra case. The guy from Venezuela, the family in that case got screwed because that is not, in my eyes, a just punishment. The truth is people can make life for themselves while incarcerated with life sentences. You can't have a life. It's not the same kind of life that people out there would sit there and dream of or want. I know there's guys that are institutionalized. People have said, I'm institutionalized. I do better in prison and blah, blah, blah. Stupid.
This call is from a federal prison.
Staying in prison and having a life is not something I would want, and I would say that there's a lot of guys that, even if they're institutionalized, this is still isn't the kind of life they dream of. Even the ones that keep coming back because they don't know how to get along out there, or they just don't have the means to make it. They keep coming back because it's the only thing they know. Those guys are, it's not like they want to have this kind of a life. I don't know, it sounds kind of contradictory, but my point is this. Everybody who is against the death penalty and says that, the person, this is a just punishment, life without the possibility of parole, just know that they still have a life. You can make a life for yourself. And if they think that person is going to suffer every day, they've got another thing coming. Humans can adapt to the worst circumstances, you know. You can go look at Skid Rows, go look at homeless camps, go look at just terrible things, concentration camps, whatever you want. People can adapt and make some kind of a life for themselves. I know guys in here that have life sentences that are doing pretty well. And if I had somebody that I loved, that somebody, one of these guys killed, and I couldn't get my hands on them, I'd rather have them have faced the death penalty than have life without parole. I hope I made that clear. Anyway, what else? That's about it for now. I said earlier, it's November the 21st. I didn't even ask today if they got a date back for me, because I don't think I might as well just have it in my head I'm going to get out January 27th, for those of you keeping tabs. Otherwise, I'm going to call back and do it, another one, unrelated topic. Thanks for your support. Take care. Bye.